He is the chair of the Parliamentary Committee on Defense and Interior. He travels internationally. In the same interview, he talked about, towards the end, he talked about going to Central African Republic. And so he cannot be unaware of how other African countries going through war look like because of the irresponsibility and the lack of leadership that is provided by politicians. He cannot pretend to be unaware that one of the challenges is how civil society organizations and the media cannot play their watchdog roles. And that's why war continues to perpetuate itself. And my other comment before I leave this is simple. We are talking about the threat, but there was a grievous component, basically accusing, since it was multimedia, of trying to sabotage government or government machinery, of corruption, of blackmail, which is even grievous, because what that seeks to do is for the people of Ghana to lose confidence in their media practitioners. If that were to happen, it takes completely backwards the progress that we have made. And that is why, for me, whilst we are addressing the threat, yes, in the immediate, maybe this week and next week, the option of providing Erastus Asare-Donko some form of security, it might be an option that can be considered. But do our journalists have to be protected by the security for them to be able to do their work? I don't think so. The environment for all journalists to be able to operate without any fear must be persistent and prevailing all the time. A journalist cannot, it's like saying that a doctor should not do their work because if they're doing their work, you have to provide them security. A teacher cannot teach because you have to provide them security. The journalist is a noble profession. Why should they be given security for doing the work that they have been trained to do? And a work that is significant for our peace, for our stability, and our democracy. So these are my initial comments. And I think that in his position in parliament, it's a very serious situation that is developing. And I will even go further to say that beyond the complaint, I don't think he has the temperament to be the chair of the Defense and Interior Committee of Parliament. It's in the interest of the MPP not to allow a prominent member of their party to be seen to be the one who consistently has now become infamous as the one who threatens the security of media practitioners. And they can do that in several ways. They can engage diplomatically and hope to change the behavior of Honorable Ken Ajapon. They can cause Ken Ajapon to issue an unqualified apology of his own conduct towards media personnel, because it might help to assuage the type of anger and unpopularity of his own actions. But if I make this observation, it is to reinforce my earlier point. If you review the literature of international human rights law, the international system frowns profusely against people in decision-making who become perpetrators to people's human rights. How much more when the people are media practitioners who in their watchdog role report abuses against people's rights. So there is a double-edged sword here, because the ones who bring to the limelight, both nationally and internationally, issues related to the protection of civilians and their rights are the media practitioners. When you threaten them, the international community takes notice. But if the one who threatens them is a decision maker, the chair of a parliamentary defense and interior committee, the international community takes it at a much serious and higher level. And that's why this becomes a very important issue for discussion.